What's going on, everyone? My name is Liam DeBoer. You're watching ET Transport, and today we're going to go over the history of Cummins Engines, find out who their customers are, and dive into some information about the company's stock. So let's get into it. Cummins is the leader in the diesel engines market, which shouldn't come as a surprise to you, because when we held a poll asking for our subscribers' preference, 52% said Cummins X15 is the best brand, a sentiment which is reflected by the market. Cummins is now the largest over-the-road truck engine manufacturer in the world and holds a 37.5% share of the heavy-duty diesel engine industry. Now, seeing as our poll revealed Cummins as the overwhelming favorite, I doubt I need to tell you why Cummins is a highly sought-after truck engine, but I'm going to anyways. So let's go over the history of the company that built an engine with the reputation of being tough, efficient, and seemingly impervious to croaking before reaching its life expectancy. Clessy Cummins, born in 1988, was the mastermind behind the company, a mastermind that dropped out of school in the 8th grade. Clessy had a natural talent for mechanics, and it is said that he built his first engine at the age of 11. Throughout his 20s, Clessy worked as a chauffeur in hopes of raising enough capital to embark on his dream, building the world's best engine. Although he wouldn't need this day job for long, William Irvin, a former employer of Clessy's, offered to invest and get Cummins Engines off the ground. So after jumping the capital hurdle, Clessy was off to the races and Cummins officially became a company in 1919. However, it didn't get off to a smooth start. The first engine produced by Cummins was a 6-horsepower motor designed for use on the farm. And while designing this motor, Clessy licensed a fuel injection system from RM HVID Company, a system that was much different than what was on the market at these times. Much like a modern day diesel, HVID technology used compression to fire instead of spark plugs or other ignition sources. But as previously mentioned, the headaches soon came. Sales for the new company were extremely disappointing, but not because people weren't buying. Rather, purchases were being returned. This is because the vast majority of the company's sales came by way of the then popular Sears catalog. But Sears had an overly generous return policy. Farmers would often use the Cummins engine for the entire harvest and then return the 6-horsepower motor at the end of the season for a full refund. Clearly, this put a bunch in William Irvin's bonnet. Although Clessy had a genius idea to solve the problem, Irvin had majority stakes in another company in California, Purity Stores Supermarkets. Clessy convinced Irvin to install the diesel engines into his fleet of trucks that the supermarkets used to deliver food and staples to his stores. In the early 1900s, Clessy's diesel engine design was far superior to those operating on gasoline, because when it came time to haul through the Californian mountains, Clessy's engine wasn't just more durable, but also more economically friendly. Had Clessy not convinced Irvin and Purity Stores to adopt this engine, the over-the-road diesel truck industry may have never become what it is today, because these trucks instantly started turning heads in the industry. But Clessy once again started to dream bigger and set his aim to the skies, to have his diesel engine find its way under the hood of commercial vehicles, which at the time seemed like an impossible achievement. In 1928, 9 years after the company's conception, Cummins started turning all of its efforts towards the automotive industry, as Clessy believed this was the way to advance his technology and brand. In a few short years, the company had designed and manufactured the first iteration of what we now know today as the diesel engine, an engine built specifically for the commercial trucking market, which would also later find its way into a plethora of heavy-duty consumer pickup trucks. To demonstrate that the Cummins engine was both more feasible and efficient than its gas counterpart, Clessy installed one of his engines into a 1926 Packard Touring sedan and hit the road. He drove from Indiana to New York City and intended to present his revolutionary engine at the 1930s New York Auto Show. Over the course of the trip, the sedan hosting Clessy's invention covered nearly 800 miles and used a mere 30 gallons of fuel, which works out to roughly 26 miles per gallon. However, seeing as Cummins was not officially registered as an exhibitor at the show, he was kindly asked to kick rocks. But instead of returning home, Clessy said screw asking for permission to talk at a conference and decided to drive to nearby Atlantic City, where another exhibit was taking place. Although this time was going to be different, Clessy rented a space directly across from the convention hall on his own dime and proudly displayed his car, which proved to be a good investment because the diesel-rigged sedan quickly grabbed more attention than most of the official exhibits at the show. In 1931, Clessy staged yet another public exhibition. He equipped a Marion truck with one of his Model U engines. He then drove this truck from New York to Los Angeles, a distance of over 3,000 miles, in just 97 hours. Keep in mind, this is more than two decades before the construction of the interstate highway system. So after his demonstration yet again proved to be successful, Plessy decided to up the ante. He rigged a bus with one of his diesel engines and then drove it from New York back to LA, another 3,000 mile journey, which he completed in 91 hours while reaching speeds of up to 65 miles per hour. This was a mind-blowing achievement at the time. Plessy's diesel bus proved to travel across the country quicker than a passenger train. This demonstration was a foreshadowing of the impact that the interstate highway system would have on society in the decades to come. Today, Cummins engines are not only used in medium and heavy duty trucks, but also manufactured for commercial engines that serve many industries. These range from construction, mining and drilling, agricultural, rail, and military defense systems. So, what now? What's the future of Cummins? Well, the company is gearing up for a zero emissions future with big plans to supply hydrogen electric power systems that produce clean fuel. While Cummins is primarily in the market of trucks, they've started turning their eyes to the train and bus industries, which they believe is a much larger commercial opportunity in both the short and long term. So, who are the Cummins customers? Well, 55% of the company's total sales are within the US, coming from companies like Chrysler, Ford, Navistar, and Paccar. Although there are foreign manufacturers such as Komatsu, who make sure Cummins sought-after engines are driving on international roads. That being said, the largest portion of their international sales could be in jeopardy, seeing as the US is currently at economic war with Cummins' largest foreign client, China. Tom Linebarger, the CEO of Cummins, says these trade wars will inevitably impact the company. He states roughly 40% of their sales and manufacturing takes place on Chinese soil. Now, what about Cummins' shares? Well, in March of 2021, the company hit an all-time high, trading at just shy of $274 a share. Fast forward to today, and their stock sits at $209, which is quite a significant drop, although still sitting pretty compared to their $166 a share price in the weeks leading up to COVID. So, is Cummins a good buying option? Well, historically it would seem so. If you had bought $10,000 worth of Cummins shares in 2016, you'd have made a smart investment and be sitting on $6,000 in gain. But with the looming threat of a trade war, and well, let's be honest, maybe an actual war, Cummins could take a hit, seeing as 40% of their business is taking place on the other side of the figurative battlefield. Although Cummins' competitors in the industry are likely to receive the exact same blow, so only time will tell how the butting heads of world superpowers will impact the stock prices within the trucking and manufacturing industries as a whole. Hopefully, the company can offset potential losses in the foreign market with its expansion into the busing and train industry. Anyways, that's all from me, folks. We'd love to hear what you think in the comments below. Does Cummins continue to reign supreme going forward? And are you worried about what economic warfare means for your investment portfolio? Also, if you enjoyed this video, please don't forget to like and subscribe, and we'll see you next time.